Study of Ramakrishna, the great master, or Leela Prasanga, written by Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. Now we shall continue from the place we had left in the last class. So we were in the introduction to the incarnation, divine incarnation as a sadhaka, spiritual aspirant. So in that, Sharadananda Ji Maharaj was taking us through the chapter Sadhaka and Sadhana. What is spiritual practices? What are real spiritual practices? And who is a spiritual aspirant? So details into what are the practices and what a aspirant should be like was given in detail. So we were seeing the two different important aspects of spiritual life, the neti neti marga, the gnana marga, in which everything is negated that is not God. The anatman is negated and only atman is taken, just like the hamsa kshira nyaya, hamsa pakshi, the swan, has a special feature whereby if you give mix up milk and water, it can take only the milk and give up the water. So likewise, in this world, taking up only that is God and giving up that which is not God, so that is Hamsa Kshira Nyaya, taking only the essence of this world, that is the Lord is interpenetrating, all-pervading in this created universe. So taking only that Lord, Atma Vastu, Paramatma Vastu, Parabrahman, and giving up that which is unreal, the sense gratification and the sense objects. So that is the real thing here. That is the important thing here. So, and the other path was accepting everything, covering everything with God. That is the iti marga, the devotional method. Now we shall see what Sharadananda Ji Maharaj wants to tell us about these two different types of sadhanas and many other things. The Upanishads, that is Vedanta, the first part of the Veda. Veda is a huge mass of knowledge. In all these Vedas are divided into four Vedas for us to easily comprehend. And the great Maharshi Vedavyasa or Krishna Dvaipayana, he edited it and he grouped it and he divided it into these four parts. And also made so many arrangements in which the first part of the Veda will deal with the righteousness, dharma. What is dharma? What is adharma? What is righteous? What is unrighteous? It will take you through that. The second part takes you to the real and the unreal, to the discrimination between the real and the unreal. So that is the second part, the last part of the Veda. So the first part of the Veda is called Veda Purva Bhaga. The second part of the Vedas is called Veda Anta. Anta means last, final. So this Veda Anta, the last part of the Vedas, are called Vedanta, or Upanishads are the ones which gives us the essence of Vedanta, that is the discrimination between the real and the unreal, eternal and the ephemeral. So that is Vedanta or Upanishads. So the Upanishads in the Vedas bear witness to the fact that man advanced along the path of negation, that is the Gnana Marga. He went on through that path of negation. And and became introspective in a short time. He found that of all the entities of the world, his own body and mind are the most intimate and immediate objects of knowledge. Sharadananda ji Maharaj is telling that the rishis of that period, Upanishadic period or Vedic period, they found that of all the entities of the world, it was his own body and mind that are the most intimate and immediate objects of knowledge. Hence, it seems to him that he would get the knowledge of the cause of the universe sooner if he proceeded to search for it through his body and mind than through the external world. You can see the present day scientists, they are also like rishis, the seers of the old. They are also in search of the truth. But what is the methodology adopted? They are searching the same truth in the external world. The external world is infinite and it will go on giving the lower truths of this external world and it will take infinite time. So they are searching and searching and searching and they are going round and round this infinite world. It will take infinite time. So our rishis and munis have also tried searching the truth in the external world like the scientists and they have found so many truths. But later on, they came to know that they found that of all the entities of the world, his own body and mind are the most intimate and immediate objects of knowledge. Hence, it seems to him that he would get the knowledge of the cause of the universe sooner if he proceeded to search for it through his body and mind. So he found that if he searches the Lord within than without, just like the present day scientists, they too tried to search the truth in the external world, that is without, and they found it will take infinite time because the external world is infinite. So if they turn that focus, concentration within their own body, within their own mind, it seemed to them that he would get the knowledge of the cause of the universe, the truth, sooner if he proceeded to search for it through his body and mind than through the external world. Again, just as by pressing with the fingers one grain of rice in the cooking pot, one can know whether all the grains in the pot have been well boiled or not. This is a beautiful analogy or example given by none other than Ramakrishna himself. He gives this example. Most of us know cooking. Present day, I think coronavirus might have taught all of us how to cook. So we are in the lockdown. Under the guidance of the mothers in the house, everyone will be cooking in turns. So we know how to cook. So while we are cooking the rice, when it is cooked 3/4 or 90%, what do we do? How do we test whether it has been cooked or not? We take up one grain of rice from the pot and then press it in our hand to see whether it is boiled or not. But some other people have the bad habit of tasting everything or putting into their mouth and with the same hand again continuing their cooking. It's a very bad practice, and now especially during the period of coronavirus, it is taught that we should not do all those things. Then virus can spread very quickly. Now the present saying from the World Health Organization is the coronavirus can be airborne too. Suppose we sneeze or we cough while we talk, the virus can be airborne. It can come into the atmosphere and stay in the atmosphere. Anybody inhaling that air also can get it. So that's why they compulsorily tell that we should wear the mask so that it doesn't become airborne. So the cooking pattern, we should not taste it, then you cannot offer it to God, or God will not receive your offering if you taste it in the beforehand and if you make it jhuta. Okay, let us not go into that. So olden days, Ramakrishna used to tell that the people, especially mothers, used to test the rice, whether it is cooked or not, by taking up one grain of rice and then pressing it. So if they do that, if it is, they will come to know whether it is boiled or not. Then they know if one grain of rice is boiled, then all the grains have boiled. So you need not go on. It's a foolish thing to do, that all the grains of rice need not be tested whether it is boiled or not. One grain is enough. Likewise, our seers and the rishis, they were so intelligent, they couldn't understand. Just by finding the truth within one unit of this universe, that is a human being, because it is based on the same principle. That is the concept of macrocosm and microcosm. So in Sanskrit, it is called as Brahmanda and Pindanda. Brahmanda means this external world, that is a macrocosm with so many galaxies, Milky Ways, and so many other things. That's termed by the telling when Divine Mother is described, she is praised. Then the words used by our great saints and seers are Akhilanda Koti Brahmanda Janani. Akhila, anda. This universe is just like the egg, the womb of Divine Mother. So in the womb of the Divine Mother, what are all there? Akhilanda Koti. Koti means it is just like billion, or 10 koti will make 1 billion. So Akhila Anda Koti, Brahmanda. Brahmanda means universes, not one universe. Koti Koti, billions of universe. She is having, the Divine Mother is having in her womb. Anda, anda means egg, womb. Akhila Anda Koti, Brahmanda Janani, the concept of millions and millions or billions of universes in the egg or the womb of Divine Mother, the Prakriti nature. So she's described like that. So that is macrocosm, the bigger one, Brahmanda, macrocosm. So what is the microcosm, the unit, the smallest? The whole macrocosm is hidden in the microcosm. Both are similar. So that microcosm concept and macrocosm was already there in our rishis in the Vedic period itself. So we are now yet groping about that matter in the 2020, our scientists are groping for that. But our scientists, the great rishis and seers, had already that some 40, 50,000 years back. So you can just imagine the greatness of our Indian or Hindu civilization, how great. We have to feel proud of our ancestry. We have to feel proud of our Hindu religion. So that is a greatness. All these things have already been found. So Brahmanda and Pindanda, the macrocosm and the microcosm. So by this example, Ramakrishna is telling, he's trying to explain about the microcosm and the macrocosm, and Sharadanandaji is trying to tell that. So just as pressing with the fingers one grain of rice in the cooking pot, one can know whether all the grains in the pot have been well boiled or not. So also, as soon as one knows in oneself the eternal universal cause, I'll again repeat it. So also, as soon as one knows in oneself the eternal universal cause, one is able to know it in other things and persons too. So just by realizing the truth behind this microcosm inside me, which is the nearest to me, then that is the same truth which is hiding behind the macrocosm too. Truths cannot be many. Infinity cannot be many. There can be only one infinity. Infinity cannot be many. The moment it becomes many, then it will not remain to be infinite. It becomes finite. So here Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling, so also as soon as one knows in oneself the eternal universal cause, one is able to know it in other things and persons too. That is why the investigation and understanding of what I am, what am I, becomes the only aim of the aspirant on the path of knowledge. So the question is asked from millions of years in India. See, that is the speciality in Hindus, the Sanatana Dharma, in the religion of Hinduism. From then onwards, their search was for the truth, truth and truth and truth alone. So, whereas the difference in the Western world is they were trying to find gold. There was gold rush, gold, diamond, all the precious things, spices. They went out of the country from Europe. They came to India. They found this Cape of Good Hope or Cape Town by Vasco da Gama in search of the way to India, because India had so much of riches, so much of diamond, gold and everything. So they wanted to trade with India, spices and everything. So they wanted a route here in the Europe. The Islamic invasion had occupied the land route, Constantinople, Turkey, and it was converted into Islamic state. And now the Europeans couldn't go through the land route to India. So it was blocked, Constantinople. So they had to find out a sea route. So they started searching, going gold rush. So the search in the European or the Western world was only for the external enjoyment, sense gratification. So it was only the two purusharthas. What are the two purusharthas? Artha and kama. What is artha? Wealth, money, vehicles, all enjoyments. Then what is kama? Kama is desire, sense gratification, fulfilling your desires. So these were the two goals only. So their effort, all the self-effort was to gain these two things. So tell a European, the Westerner, that there is gold somewhere, there is diamond somewhere, there are things which you can enjoy, and there will be rush. They will rush there. They will even stake their life, sacrifice their life and happiness and everything, go in search of it. There always gold rush, gold rush. But what about India from time immemorial, from millions of years? So the Purusharta was not just Artha and Kama. That is what Ramakrishna has simplified all that thing. What is Artha and Kama? He used to tell the same thing in its local language, Kama Kanchana. He simplified that. He still went deeper to tell Artha and Kama as lust and greed. He went into the qualities, lust and greed. That's the same thing, Artha and Kama. So that is the only goal of the Western world and the materialistic world. But what about our rishis and munis? What about our ancestors? So they were in search of four purusharthas, goals of life. What was the first? Dharma, righteousness. Then came Artha and Kama, these two goals. So you can only get artha, wealth, righteously. So it has to be first righteousness. You should know what is righteousness, dharma. So through dharma, you have to get artha and kama. You have to fulfill your desires. You need not give up everything, artha and kama. You can. You have the right to do that. They never forbid you to earn wealth, earn money, all the things, enjoyments, and go on enjoying the world. But it should be based on righteousness, not by hook or crook, not by troubling others the way we see. What did the Europeans, the colonial people did? And now in the name of modern multinational companies, what are they doing? In the name of trade and other things, they're trying to grab money. You can see what is happening in the international world. I will not go international fora. You know very well than me. They're after making money. That's all. What will be the condition of that person? They don't think. So just money, artha and kama, their enjoyments, that's all. Even now that is taken different forms, that's all. Then it was colonial way. They used to come in the ships, go to different lands like America. They killed all the Red Indians. In Australia, they killed all the aborigines. In India, they've created so much of what you call famines and all artificial problems and killed so many people. Millions of people were killed just for their trade and gaining more money. So all this was done. What was their pursuit? Was it after truth? No, it was after gold, money and enjoyment. Artha and Kama was only their goal. But what about our great ancestors, Indians? Their goal was dharma and moksha, liberation. What is liberation? God, truth. To find out the truth, Parabrahma, the reality, the cause of the universe was their goal. Dharma was their goal, righteousness. So Artha and Kama was also there, but they were subservient. They were sandwiched between dharma and moksha. Moksha means gaining the truth, search of the truth. That is moksha, liberation. Freedom, eternal freedom, truth, the highest truth. So dharma is righteousness. So they were kept sandwiched in between Artha and Kama. So these two, Artha and Kama, were subservient to righteousness and search of truth, God, or Parabrahma, or truth, or awareness, or consciousness, whatever you may call. So these were our ancestors. They were our Hindu earlier people proponents. So from millions of years, they are in search of the truth, and they went, they internalized it. They went inside. So also, as soon as one knows in oneself the eternal universal cause, one is able to know it in other things and persons too. That is why the investigation and understanding of what am I, who am I, what am I, becomes the only aim of the aspirant on the path of knowledge. So they gave more important. Now you ask Indians, even now, in those days too, you tell Indians that there is famous manifestation of God or truth in the depth of freezing Himalayas, in the cave of Amarnath, in Kedarnath, where it will be minus 50, minus 60. And they, you tell them in the deep forest or in the caves of height of this thing, some mountains, some rishi or muni or a man of realization is sitting, they will sacrifice their life and run, rush there in their old age. I have seen while going to Amarnath Yatra, it was nearly a 40-kilometer trek. You have to walk. It's very difficult, hilly terrain, not plain road, hilly terrain, stone, mud, no tar road or no metal road. Only very slippery path. If it rains, gone case. You have to put your life in stake. There will be landslides. So every inch, it is full of danger, but they don't care. Why? They want to seek the truth, manifestation of God. Somewhere deep in the Himalayas, in the caves of Amarnath, in Kedarnath, Gangotri, Yamunotri, they rush. Millions of people, even now in India, they are in search of the truth. Gold, diamond, yes, some people may go. But God, godly people, rishis and saints are sitting. Indians and Hindus rush there. They are not for gold rush. They are rushing for truth. Eternal cause of this universe. They will sacrifice their life for this. I have seen how much trouble they used to take while going to Amarnath, while coming back after my having the darshan of the Lord and Amarnath, while coming back, I saw so many people, blind people. One person I saw, he doesn't have two legs. His two legs are just defunct with polio. The legs are just simply there, that's all. It's not grown. He was walking on hands, two hands. The legs were only just like support, that's all, nothing else. So he was walking all that 36 kilometers or 40 kilometers trekking, hilly terrain, uphill task, with the two hands he was walking. And how many days it would take for him? Blind people going there, old people going there. Why? In search of truth, in search of God. These were our ancestors, these are our ancestors. That is Hindu religion. So we are in search of truth and truth alone. They don't want this Artha and Kama. Yes, by the influence of the Western civilization and the modern education, they are turning their eyes towards these enjoyments, Artha and Kama. Let them do. After some days, after association, after they get Vairagya, when they come to know nothing is there in that, they will also turn internalized, because the tradition is there. All great rishis and seers and sages have left this beautiful tradition here. They too will come back. Nothing to worry about that. So now, that's what Sharda Prabha, Shardanandaji Maharaj is telling. That is why the investigation and understanding of what am I, who am I, the great recent, some 30, 40 years, they lived when incarnation of Lord Subramanya in Tamil Nadu, in Tiruvannamalai. He was called Ramana Maharshi. He realized in his younger days itself, as in childhood itself, the truth. You are sitting in that cave in Thiruvannamalai, near the temple. All his legs and everything because of sitting. The worm, it was worm eaten. Sat on that one place. All the worms were eating. Just naked, sitting, naked in meditation. Ramana Maharshi. Then one old lady saw this boy sitting there in meditation. She used to go put the medicine, wash him. He's not conscious. He's sitting in deep meditation. Give him food and saved him. Then she used to dress him because he was just the small child of some 14 or 15. He's in that meditation. So she used to dress, she used to give food. He was unconscious, thinking of the Atman and Paramatma Swarupa itself. And what is his statement? The first statement Ramana Maharshi gives is, in Tamil language, Naan Yaar, meaning, who am I? Go in search of that. Who am I? Who really am I? So that is the search of our ancestors. Ramana Maharshi's first question itself, it tells, Naan Yaar, who am I in Tamil? That's why the investigation and understanding of what am I became the only aim of the aspirant on the path of knowledge. We have heard, we have said before that the notion about the universe held by the generality of people has to be renounced both by men on the path of knowledge and by those on the path of devotion. Only with Vairagya we can proceed renunciation and dispassion. Why? We have said before, Sharadananda Jimaji is telling, that the notion about the universe, present day, we are seeing the universe only for our sense gratification. So that notion for just enjoyment of the universe held by the generality of people has to be renounced, both by men and women on the path of knowledge and by those on that of devotion also. Anyway, whichever you want, it has to be by renouncing the bad things, the wrong things. Then only you can move forward. I gave you the example of Ramakrishna giving, what is the basics of science? Two things cannot occupy the same place at the same time. Ramakrishna used to give through the example of keeping one place, one hand at one place. Then if you have to keep your another hand in the same place at the same time, you cannot. You have to remove this hand. In the same way, this concept of the world as just for sense gratification, enjoyment, has to be gradually given up. In the path of devotion. So everywhere both it is giving up is there. So that's why Sharadananda Jimaji is telling, we have said before that the notion about the universe held by the generality of people has to be renounced both by people on the path of knowledge and by those on that of devotion. By the complete renunciation, you have to note that Sharadananda Jimaji is trying to give you what is real sadhana, what is real spiritual life. No compromises, correct picture is given. So you have to note what are all these things, because if we really are spiritual aspirants, then we have to understand all these things. We should not just blindly go forward or mechanically or just like machineries, we should not move forward. We should understand things and then go forward. So by the complete renunciation of it, man becomes free from all mental modifications and is thereby fit for samadhi. This kind of samadhi is called in the scriptures nirvikalpa samadhi. Nirvikalpa. Nir means no. Vikalpa means the two differentiation. What is that? There will be no subject-object relationship. Now, when you every time define what is a sentence in the grammar, in our primary school days, they used to tell, define a sentence. Sentence is having these two things. What is that? The subject and the predicate. What is that? There you can see the relationship of subject and object. So there should be a verb, combination of verb, noun. So the noun is the subject. The predicate and other things, the work done by the verb, the action done by the subject to gain or the in relationship with the object. So now, I exist and I go on doing all this world, having the relationship of the sense object in this world for my sense gratification. So here in samadhi, nirvikalpa, that vikalpa is not there. What is that vikalpa? The subject-object relationship is lost. Only subject remains. I alone remain. Subject and object become one. So that is nirvikalpa samadhi. So we shall tell, I have already earlier explained there are so many kinds of samadhis from Raj Yoga. I gave a detailed explanation in the earlier classes. So by the complete renunciation of it, man becomes free from all mental modifications, that is chitta vritti. Mental modifications means chitta vrittis, the waves which comes up in the mind matter, chitta. So the mental modifications, chitta vritti, and is thereby fit for samadhi. This kind of samadhi is called in the scriptures nirvikalpa samadhi. We shall tell the reader elsewhere in chapter 3 how the aspirant on the path of knowledge makes the effort to know who am I, how he attains the nirvikalpa samadhi, and what kind of experience he has at that time. Now the reader should be told a little of how the aspirant on the path of devotion arrives at the realization of that superconscious state. So the Gnani goes and gets the same thing. But how does he negates everything? He is only after the truth and goes and gets it, superconscious state, beyond this senses and the body and the senses. But how does the devotee who accepts everything is God, iti path? Iti means this. Neti means not this. The positive way. Accepting everything as God and going forward. That is called the path of devotion. So how does he realize that same superconscious state? In Bhagavad Gita, when Arjuna asks Krishna, where does the man of devotion, Karma Yogi, go? How does he, what does he reach? Is this path better, the path of Sankhya, that is the path of knowledge, Jnana Yoga, or the path of devotion, which is better, which is higher? Then Krishna tells, both of them take to the same goal, superconscious state or Parabrahman, the truth. But the one that is the path of knowledge is a little difficult. You should base everything on your self-effort only. There will be no help. So it's very, very difficult. The terrain is very, very difficult. Only people who don't have body consciousness, they are fit to go through that path. But the path of devotion is suitable for everyone, all and sundry. So no problem. Everybody can take up and it's easy. There will be help of the Guru. There will be the help of the Ishta Devata, the personal God. So there, the personal God is denied. God without form, God without attributes is taken up. So no help from the personal God because you have denied it. And at the most, you may get a little help from the Guru in the path of Jnana. So that is very, very difficult. Only people who don't have the body consciousness, Dehatma Buddhi, so they can proceed easily. Otherwise, for others, it is very, very difficult. But others, it will be the most difficult. But the path of devotion is easy. Everybody can. So that's why Krishna tells, both take to the same super conscious goal. But if you ask me, it is better to take up Bhakti Yoga. The whole chapter is called Bhakti Yoga, Path of Devotion in Bhagavad Gita. If you go to that chapter, it is 12th chapter. In Bhagavad Gita is Bhakti Yoga. So in that, Krishna tells all about these things. So that we can see. So now Sharadanandaji Maharaj wants to take us through the Bhakti Yoga, how it will lead to the same super conscious state, just like the Advaita or Jnana Yoga. How does it take? We have designated the path of devotion as the path of this, iti. Everything is God. Everything here is God. For although the traveler on this path has the actual knowledge of the transience of the world, he believes in God, its creator, and has a conviction of the reality and existence of the world created by him. The devotees look upon the world and all things and persons in it as related with God and makes them his own. He shuns whatever he believes to be an obstacle on the path of leading to the realization of that relation. It becomes the devotee's immediate ideal to become absorbed in his Ishta Devata, chosen deity, in him through the love of and meditation on one of his forms, and also to perform all actions out of love for him. We look upon the worship of Brahma Samaj as a meditation on the form of God only. For when anyone meditates on a personality possessed of noble qualities, but no form, he is bound to think of one or other of such thing as ether, water, air, fire, etc. So you have to, even in meditation of Brahma Samaj, they may tell we are doing it on formless, but with attributes. So they too are people, worshippers of devotion only, path of devotion, accepting everything as God. So because they have taken up formlessness, it is not that they are Jnana Yogis. To take up Jnana Yoga is much, much more difficult. You have to go for attributeless and formless and very, very difficult path. So Sharadanandaji is explaining about the path of devotion. So now we will go and see about that introduction to sadhaka and sadhana in the next session, that is tomorrow. Now we shall go to a little explanation of the yesterday's. We continued about our Ashtapasha. So we will see one or two pashas. So the bondages which are binding us to this world, to this Maya, and not allowing us to realize our real nature, which is already within us. Some bondages is pulling down. It's not allowing us. So the thread is tied to us. The moment you try to go forward, go up to reach this reality, it is pulled down. So I'll give an example. Ramakrishna used to give this example. You know, there are lizards in the house. The whole house lizard. So the lizard in the villages, the children, they want to play with everything they get. So in Kamarpukur, the children used to play like this. They used to catch hold of a lizard in the house and tie a thread to its waist. And then they used to leave a long rope. Long rope in the sense, not a rope, because the lizard is itself so small. It's called tik-tiki in Bengali, the name, because it makes tik-tik-tik sound. So in Bengali language, that house lizard, very big than the other lizards I have seen, house lizards in other places. Especially in Bengal, I've seen them very big size. It's big. So they make that sound tick tick. So it is called, the name of this thing is tick ticky. So they tie a thread, small thread, thin thread to the waist of that. And the other end of the thread is tied with the stone, a small piece of stone. So the children, they play like that. Innocence, it's not cruelty, though it is cruel to that animal, out of their innocence. So just like in the other part of India, they used to catch hold of this bumblebee or beetle. They will try a thread. It will be making that sound, going Brahmara sound. They used to keep it in a matchbox. And they used to try a silken thread. Then it, just like the kite, they used to allow it to fly. It will fly. So they used to play, the children used to play with that bee, beetle. So like that, here too, these boys are playing. So what will that now lizard do? It will try to climb the wall going up to its house, wherever it is. Now, because the thread would allow it to go to the top, very near to the house, it has gone into the house, about to enter. Now the thread is over now. The length of the thread is over. The stone, weight of the stone starts pulling. So the lizard is about to enter the house, it falls down. Again, it tries to go. So each time it tries, the thread, the bondage, and the weight of the stone will pull it down. So this example was given by Ramakrishna about our desires and other things, all these bondages which are pulling us down. The karmas, all these bondages are come because of our bad karmas. The work, the actions, the bad actions which we have done, all those are staying in us in the form of these bad karmas, the weight. It's called bhoja, weight, heavy weight on our back, which is not allowing us to. And what is that tying all that karmas to us, to our ego, is this thread. What is that thread? Pasha. Pasha is that thread, a rope, bandhana, bondage. It is tying that. So it will not allow you to go forward in spiritual life. So how it can be overcome? It will be coming in the end. So now let us go forward to see what is the, we were studying, we finished the third pasha bondage, that is the fear, bhaya. We were about to study the fourth one, that is shanka, doubt. So shanka means doubt. Anumana, sometimes anumana is inference, but the exact word is shanka in Sanskrit, doubt. This fourth bondage is shown as dhaumra, demon. The demon in Saptashati, in Durga Saptashati, it is shown as the Dhaumra demon. Shumba is commanding that demon to go and fight the Divine Mother. that is our all the doubts arise due to this. Why do we get doubts? All the doubts arise due to distorted or false knowledge. Because of the false knowledge and the distorted knowledge, half-baked knowledge, we will not try to understand it fully. We will read very little, and with that half-baked knowledge, distorted knowledge, false knowledge, doubts come up, shankha. Our 10 organs and 10 Mahabhutas. What are the Mahabhutas? Earth, water, air, fire, ether. These are the 5 Bhutas. There are 2 types. The subtlest one and the gross one. This is the Panchabhutas, and the after the subtle Panchabhutas, Sukshma Bhutas, these 5, earth, water, air, fire, and ether. After quintuplication, Panchikarana, they become the gross. Whatever you see in this world is a gross expression of that original Bhutas. Our scientists are trying to find out that original matter, that is chemistry. Study of chemistry is to find out the original matter. They have divided and divided, and they have found out the molecules, and the molecules is divided. Then they have found the atomic atoms. The atom is divided, and they have found the subatomic particles, and even now the subatomic particles are divided, and they have reached to quarks. That's all. They're still going forward. So our Rishi Munis in those days, 30,000, 40,000 years back, they had already reached the original elements. What are they? The 5 elements: earth, water, air, fire, ether. The original elements, not the what you see, the gross here. And they have gone even deeper than that and found out the original matter, the subtlest, that is Akasha. That's called Akasha. Akasha means not the sky or the space. Or the ether concept is also wrong. There's the original matter. So now, the 5 gross element and 5 subtle elements, together with, that is the 10 Mahabhutas and 10 organs. So, our 10 organs and 10 Mahabhutas, earth, water, air, fire, ether, fine gross, a fine subtle plane, are their soles. Hence, Shumbha calls for 100 Dhaumra demons to win the war against good, that is Divine Mother. Doubts keeps the ego busy. Because of all this doubt, you don't believe, you don't get faith. It's the opposite of faith, Shraddha. You'll be doubting everybody. Your Guru Vakya, your father and mother, you'll be doubting everybody. Your own spouses, wife and husband and children, you don't believe in anybody. You don't have faith in anybody. So that will keep your ego busy, thus keeping it entangled in Maya in this world. And it will not help you to get realization. It will be always binding you down. This is the Pasha. It's called Shanka, doubt. So we'll go to the 5th bondage, that is Jugupsa. What is this Jugupsa? This is a Sanskrit word, Jugupsa. The English meaning is censure, reproach, aversion. When due to false knowledge, we see others as different from us, due to the wrong knowledge, due to the selfishness, due to the intense desire to enjoy this world, due to this false knowledge, we see others as different from us. We separate. We censure others to prove ourselves right. This too is treated as the 5th bondage of the soul. They are also of 100 types, as in the above, that is the Shankha. They are also 100 types, Jugupsa. It's also bondage. It will pull us down. It will not allow us to reach the goal. The 6th bondage is Kula, caste, the family, or the other things which I am born in, the qualities which I have, Kula, caste. So we'll see about that in the next class. We'll go to the proper study of Ramakrishna's life now. Now, last time we saw how Ramakrishna started doing his spiritual practices while doing puja. He started doing that with intense devotion and love towards mother, and the way, different ways by which he used to approach Divine Mother while worshipping. It was not just a mechanical worship. It was not a drudgery. It was full of love, devotion, renunciation, and everything. How he used to pour out his emotions towards God. Let us see. We had studied it in the last class, but again we will go through that a little about that so that we will remember it. Ramakrishna, at that time during puja, he thought devotees like Ramaprasad, Kamalakanta and many other saints, they were devotee singers. Had the vision of the mother, divine mother, they had the vision. So it is certain that the mother of the universe is realizable, so it gave him more faith. Yes, they had the vision, then mother is true. I too can realize them. So the mother of the universe is realizable. Why can I not then be blessed with the vision? He used to say with an eager heart, thou didst show thyself to Ramaprasad, mother. Why then should thou not reveal thyself to me? I don't want wealth. I don't want friends. I don't want relatives. I don't want enjoyment of pleasures and the like. Do show thyself to me, divine mother, my dear mother. Do show thyself to me. He would pray and cry this way while his bosom was flooded with streams of tears from his eyes. By this, the heaviness of his heart lessened a little. Urged by a fond hope, he would be somewhat reassured like a child and became ready to please the goddess by singing for her again. He thus went on spending his days in worship, meditation, and the singing of devotional songs. His love and longing for her increased daily. So until this, we had studied in the last session in great details. Now we will go forward to see what Sharadanandaji Maharaj is describing about the sadhana, the spiritual practice of Sri Ramakrishna. Thus, the wonderful worshippers scheduled a period of time for performing the worship and service of the goddess went on increasing. So now, most of us while doing puja, we will restrict to a very short time. We'll go to the temple, do little tidbits very fast, ring the bell, throw some flowers, throw some objects there, do this thing, as if we have done something great to God by throwing something on the head of the God and just coming, ringing the bell, lighting the lamp, agarbatti, so fast. Everything is so fast, mechanical, just like a machinery. You should see them ringing the arati. You should see them going through the agarbatti. So fast. Everything is so fast. So we do all that mechanically, just like a machinery, and come back. But what does the worship, wonderful worshippers, scheduled period of time for performing the worship and service of the goddess went on increasing day by day. He sat for worship and placing a flower on his head. So in the puja, there is one thing. While you are meditating, you have to place the flower on your own head of the Sahasrara, then meditate, and then other ritual will be done. So likewise, when he sat for worship and placing a flower on his head, according to that is Manasa Puja. The puja now we are doing on Monday. Evening we are doing the puja, the science of worship or the significance of worship. In that, it will come this one next, I think after 3 or 4 steps, we are reaching that Manasa Puja. In that, you have to, in the Manasa Puja, the internal puja, the external puja is the worship we do externally with all the objects. But all that thing is done within, inside the mind. That's called Manasa Puja, the mental worship. Then in that process, you have to take the flower, keep it on the head, the Sahasrara, the place of the Parabrahma or Shiva or Guru. Then you have to meditate and do all this thing in your own heart. Inside your heart, you have to do the same worship what you are doing externally. You have to replace all those things with mental qualities. The flower will be replaced by different qualities, good qualities of yours. Then the chamara, you are fanning the things. So the Vayu Tattva is used for that. For Arati, you are using the Agni Tattva, which is in your body as a doing the, what do you call, the Arati to the God. So like that, so many things are replaced by different qualities and other things in your own body and mind. And you will be doing, no external objects will be there. It all internal objects is converted into that. And that is Manasa Puja. So Manasa Puja has to be done compulsorily in the puja process. So we are coming to that Manasa Puja maybe after 5 or 6 steps. So here, when Ramakrishna was doing in that process of puja, the Manasa Puja is to keep that flower on the head at the Sahasrara, then sit for meditation to do internal worship. What would happen? He sat for worship and placing a flower on his head, according to scriptural injunctions, perhaps remained motionless like the trunk of a tree. How will the trunk of a tree be? Not even a single motion. Sthanu, it's called sthanu, means the trunk of a tree. No motion. Like that Ramakrishna sitting for internal worship in meditation, keeping, placing that flower on the head, you'd be sitting in such a way that not a single motion. Sthanu, like a stump of a tree. Meditating for 2 long hours. There, in the process of puja, because you have to complete it within 40 minutes or 1 hour in the puja, so you have to do it very quick. Manasa puja means it. You place your this thing, close your eyes, then do it, tell the mantra fast, and within 5 or 6 minutes or even 4 minutes, you have to finish it off that and go. But what is Ramakrishna doing? So placing a flower on his head, according to scriptural injunctions, perhaps remained motionless like a trunk of a tree, meditating for 2 long hours. After offering cooked food and other things to the mother, he perhaps spent a long time thinking that she was taking the food which has been offered. So he used to stay there as if while we are serving food to some people, we stand near the table. We will be looking at their plates. If there are great people, elderly people, or the gurus have come to your house, how will you feed them? So you take so great care. Everything will be set to the plate and everything as they are eating. You bring everything, give the items one by one. You will not put in a hurry, small quantity. Then the other curries are put, pickle is put, papad is given. And slowly wait until they finish talking. Talk to them. They will be talking and slowly asking, how is the food? Eat slowly. So like that, after that again, you serve them with take care, great care. So it may take half an hour or even 40 minutes. So you go on serving with great care. Likewise, Ramakrishna is feeling Divine Mother is taking the food when the Naivedya is done. So it is not just to be finished off in 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Patapat, patapat. Throw some water and come on, eat it and take away. No, it is not like that. Ramakrishna would feel Divine Mother is eating everything slowly and feeding Mother, thinking that she is taking everything bit by bit. After offering cooked food and other things to the Mother, he perhaps spent a long time thinking that she was taking them. Again, perhaps he spent a long time every morning in decorating the goddess with garlands made of flowers plucked with his own hands. So Ramakrishna used to go early in the morning, pluck the flowers from the plant, different garden. It was a big garden was there. Different flowers are plucked. He himself will sit, wash all those things, then make them garland. I think in India, the mothers are expert in making the garlands. They will be weaving it so fast. I think I have not seen that way it is done in here, in South Africa. But there I have seen, they are trained from the childhood, even in the house. They allow special technique. They will do it very fast. The garlands are wound very fast. So like that, Ramakrishna had learned that art. Ramakrishna would not be left behind in anything. See, now you can see another mastery. He could go pluck the flowers and make them garland, beautiful garlands. That was also an art. It's not an ordinary thing. Ramakrishna used to go pluck the flowers himself. The other things what we do is bought from the market and we do that. But Ramakrishna himself used to select the best flower from the trees and weave it and do it in such a way, bind it into a garland, beautiful garland, and bring that garland. So decorating the goddess with garland made of flowers plucked with his own hand. Or he remained engaged for a very long time in performing the evening arati with a heart filled with loving devotion. Again, singing for the mother of the universe in the afternoon. Or at the end of the arati, he sometimes became so much absorbed in and overwhelmed with spiritual emotions that he could be made to perform the arati. He would be overwhelmed with spiritual emotions. He sometimes became so much absorbed in and overwhelmed with spiritual emotions that he could be made to perform the arati, the evening service of food offering, etc., only when he had been reminded again and again and that it was getting late for those services. Somebody had to tell him, it's getting late, do it fast. Then only he could move forward. The worship continued thus for a time in this manner. It is clear that the attention of the people of the temple was drawn towards the master when they saw such devotion. People cannot understand. They are used to just doing it mechanically. just as a service or a job in the office, get some money and do your work, duty and go off, that's all. It was not like that. It was not for money. It was for devotion, to realize the truth. So his was a different puja. Suppose if one sheep falls to the ditch while going, all the 100 sheep should go and fall into the ditch. Suppose one sheep doesn't go and fall into the ditch, the other sheep will think it doesn't belong to our group. It doesn't belong to sheep class. Put him out. Odd man out, odd sheep out. So now all are going in a different passion, behind money, enjoyments, and all the puja and everything is done mechanical way, just for earning some money, bundling some plantain and coins and rice. That's what Ramakrishna used to tell. Ramakrishna is not doing puja in that manner. It's for devotion. It's for service of the Divine Mother. He's seeing it. He's feeling it. So naturally, when you don't fall to the ditch, other people will see who is not doing like that. Us, like us, is not imitating us. Is something different. Is not. It doesn't belong to our category. So now what will they think? If you start thinking out of the box, doing something special, some nut has become loosened. He's gone mad. So naturally people started thinking, what is this? What kind of worship is he doing? He's not following any injunctions. He's doing it so much. He's taking so much of time. He's doing whatever he way, his whims and fancies. They don't know what is happening within. So they are just seeing the external and thinking Ramakrishna has gone mad. So it's clear that the attention of the people of the temple was drawn towards the master when they saw such devotion, eagerness and spiritual steadfastness on his part. People at first derided and ridiculed a person. People at first deride and ridicule a person who is seen to give up the path generally followed by them and to conduct himself or to do something in a novel way. When the first scientist who wanted to start a steamboat, earlier the boat was rowing, they used to row. So after the steam engine was found, he fixed that steam engine to the boat for the first time, and the scientist told all the people, announced that today I'm going to move the boat without oars, without rowing. Oh, all started jeering and booing at him. It's impossible. How can you move the boat without rowing, without the oars? You are really a fool. They started booing him. Highly impossible. He cannot do it. It's all bluffing. All tomorrow when we go there, it will be all a bluff and people, we can nicely scold him and tease him. So all were ready to ridicule him. And there, the moment the boat started moving, the steam engine, with that steam engine, it was very old type of steam engine. You have to put the coal just like this steam engine train. You put the coal, then it should burn. Then with that steam was released, then the boat would move. So now the boat started moving without the oars, without rowing. Now they were ready to ridicule him and they were already criticized him. Told impossible, the boat will not move, but it started moving. So, but now they cannot accept the defeat. Then they started criticizing him. What was the criticism? Oh, the boat is moving now, but you cannot stop it. So whatever you do, they will criticize. That is the nature of the people. They will criticize you. So ridicule you. First they told, can't, highly impossible, he cannot move the boat without rowing, without oars, highly impossible. But now when he started moving, not caring for their ridicule and criticism, then he told, oh, the boat has started, now it cannot be stopped. Whatever you do, they will criticize. That's the nature of the people. Do not worry about them. They are just like the dogs barking at the elephant going on the road. So do not give your words to all those criticism. Don't be deterred by that. Don't get afraid of that. Whatever you think is true, go on doing it. Go on striving. Do not be bothered by those things. So the same thing was done by Ramakrishna here. People at first deride and ridicule a person who is seen to give up the path generally followed by them and to conduct himself or to do something in a novel way. But with the passage of time and the perseverance of that person in the path, despite all criticism, their attitude changes and reverence takes its place. There is a great saying of Swami Vivekananda. What is that? Any good path, any good action. Suppose you want to do something good. Anything, anybody who want to do good, they have to undergo, pass through these stages, three important stages. What is that? The first thing is, any good work you start, the first thing is opposition. Whatever you try to do, anything good, the first thing from the public will be opposition, from your own family, from your near and dear ones, opposition. You can't do it. It's impossible. Don't do like that. Go through the normal course. Don't do novel things. Don't think out of the box. Opposition. So you have to pass through any good work, any good thinking, any good endeavor has to pass through these three stages that Swami Vivekananda tells. The first thing is opposition. If you still persist, if you still try, you continue with that endeavor, not giving up, then the next stage which you have to pass is, after opposition, criticism. They will criticize you, they will deride you, they will be speak behind the back, they will assassinate, character assassinate you. They will do all sorts of things, backbiting and everything, criticize you. Do not care. Go on doing. If you think that is good and right, it's on the path of righteousness, anything good, whether business or studies or anything, continue. Do not give up. Second step is criticism. If you still persist, then comes the next stage, that is acceptance. Every good work, everybody is to undergo these three processes. So remember that, so that you will not be worried and disturbed by all these things. The first step is opposition. The second step is criticism. The third step is acceptance. Even before that, there is one more step Swami Vivekananda tells. What is that? After criticism, if you still persist, if you still go on doing the good work, any good work for that sake, it has to pass through these stages. The first is opposition. The second is criticism. Then before acceptance, there is one more stage that's called, they will ignore you. Oh, I told him so much, advised him not to do that. Didn't I tell you? But that fellow is not heeding my words at all. Let him go and get destroyed. What is that to me? I will not care. Let him get destroyed. Let him spoil his life. I've advised him so many times. Still he's persisting with that. So they will ignore you. The next state after criticism is ignore. Let him do whatever he wants. Let him go and die. Let something happen to him. What is that botheration to me? So if you still persist after that too, then is acceptance, that they will respect you. Oh, we told so many things, he still never gave up. He succeeded in it. He's really great. So finally comes acceptance. Whatever good work you start up, Swami Vivekananda tells, it has to pass through these stages. What is that? Opposition. Don't give up. Hard, try hard. Put on your effort. Persist. Then the next stage is criticism. Do not worry. Don't get bothered. Don't get depressed. Don't become anxious. Continue with that. Do the good work. Whatever you think is right and righteous, do it. Then finally, after the criticism, they will ignore you. Then finally, it is acceptance. Everybody has to undergo that. Any good person, anybody who is trying something, doing something special, has to undergo these three stages. Now, Ramakrishna is also undergoing that, but he is not at all bothered. He can't give his mind to all those things at all because his mind is so much focused on Divine Mother, realizing God, the truth. So people at first deride and ridicule a person who is seen to give up the path generally followed by them and to conduct himself or to do something in a novel way. But with the passage of time and the perseverance of that person in the path, despite all criticism, their attitude changes and finally comes reverence. Then they will start revering you. Takes its place, acceptance and reverence. Then they will respect you, they will reward you. Then they will make you to sit on the throne. But what were the other hard difficulties you had to face? Criticism, opposition, ignoring you, backbiting, everything you have to undergo. Difficulties will come. Don't get bothered. Go forward. The master's case was no exception to this rule. Soon after he started his novel form of worship, he became the object of many people's derision. Sometimes later, some people began to revere him also. Some people who can understand him, they have a lot of devotion. They cannot do. When they saw him doing that, they started revering him. So much of devotion. But most of the people started deriding him, opposing him, criticizing him. Sometime later, some people began to revere him. It is said the Mathur saw the master's worship at this time and said that with great delight to Rani Rasmani. Mathurnath, the son-in-law of Rani Rasmani, saw the puja once of Ramakrishna, the way, novel way. So much of devotion he used to do the worship of Divine Mother. So Mathur saw the master's worship at this time and said that with great delight. He went and reported it to Rani Rasmani with great delight. What was that statement of Mathur Babu to Rani Rasmani? He told, we have got an extraordinary worshipper. We have got an extraordinary worshipper. The goddess will be awakened very soon. The goddess will be awakened very soon. The master never deviated from his own course on account of the opinions of the people. He doesn't know what is happening outside. Where is the time for all those things? All his mind is focused on realization of the truth, Divine Mother, service of the Disciple. Where does he have the mind? Well, can he think of Mathur is praising him or somebody is criticizing? No. His focus is just concentrated on God and God alone. There is a story told by Ramakrishna himself. What was that? There was one saint sitting on the river, bank of the river, and thinking of God, meditating. So there was a person who was sitting on the bank of a river and meditating, thinking to do puja, think of God. So there was one very, very intense lover. He was in love with some woman. So that great lover was going behind that woman to attract her attention. She was just ignoring him and going away. So he was so much behind her, going to her. He forgot what is around. So while going, moving behind that woman, that fallen woman, this great lover or that person, he didn't see this person meditating and doing puja. He stamped on him. His leg touched that person. Person who was worshipping got angry. Scolded him. What kind of a ruffian are you? What kind of a ill-mannered person are you? I'm meditating on God. I'm trying to meditate on God. And you just going behind that fallen woman, you ignore everything, puja and everything, you stamped upon my puja and myself. You've done committed such a sin. You know what was the reply of that person who was running behind that fallen woman? He told, I'm attracted towards that fallen woman. And I am going behind her with so much of concentration. I was oblivious because of the attraction of that fallen woman. I'm oblivious of the surroundings. But you are meditating on the highest attraction that is a God. You are the lover of God. I am just lover of a fallen woman. You are the lover of the great almighty God. And how can you think that, or how can you take out your mind that I have stamped you or this thing? There is no focus at all. How can you know that I am going behind a fallen woman and other things when you are I myself, an ordinary person behind a fallen woman, I have so much focus on that. But you are thinking you are the lover of a great almighty God and you don't have focus at all. What kind of focus is that? Then that person came to know what wrong he is doing. I don't have focus on the worship at all. I'm just aware of all the things outside happening. No concentration. So Ramakrishna gives this story, Vilva Mangala. It comes from the story of Vilva Mangala. Gospel, you can find it and then it is shown. Now Ramakrishna was so intensely after the Divine Mother, search of the truth, worshipping. He is not at all aware of the external things. Whoever scolds, whoever talks good of him, criticizes him. So where is the question of him being disturbed? You give ears and your senses to all these things, you get disturbed. You don't have time. If you had time, for that, he would have meditated more, he would have done more japa and more worship. If he had more time to think of all these things, with that time, he could have done more. I just want to tell you one humorous story. There was a competition. How much laddu sweets one person can eat? The more the laddus or more sweet he eats, he gets the prize. So one person went there, he wanted to participate in the competition. So many people were trying. So they had eaten already 40, 50 laddus and you have to surmount them. So this fellow went somewhere. He told, he gave that money, he entered the competition, just I will go out and come. He went there and came back again. And he ate 100 laddus and he won the competition. Then the person there asked him, where did you go outside somewhere? You paid the money for the competition, for the laddu eating competition, sweet eating competition, and you went away somewhere. Where did you go? Told, see, other people were eating 40, 50 laddus. So I was not sure about myself. So I went and practiced 50, 60 laddus, ate in the sweet shop there. I practiced it and then came for the competition. So yes, already eaten 50, 60 laddus, practiced it. And then afterwards he came and ate more than 100 laddu and won the competition. So they were afraid what was going to happen. He has already eaten 100 more laddus. He might, his stomach might get upset. So they told, we will give you medicine, take this medicine. Then what was the reply of that person who participated in the competition of eating laddus? Told, if I had space, if I take little space to eat that medicine, I would have eaten much more laddus. There's no space at all. If I had space to take that medicine, I would have consumed much more laddus. There is no space for even that. So like that, here, while thinking and meditating on God or doing good work like studies or whatever higher things you want to achieve, anything higher, with the mind you can give for all these other outside criticisms and other people, botheration of the outer world, hearing the news, going for some entertainment, with that mind you could have done more japa, you could have done more worship, you could have studied more, concentrated more, done more good work using that energy or the part of the mind which you have given for these things. Ramakrishna didn't have time for all those things, for criticisms or praises. His mind was just focused and focused on Divine Mother. Sometimes later, some people began to revere him. It is said that the master saw, the Mathur saw master's worship and he reported it to Rani Rasmani. We have got an extraordinary worshipper. Not ordinary, extraordinary worshipper. The goddess will be awakened very soon. But the master never deviated from his own course on account of the opinion of the people. He doesn't know the opinion at all. Like a river flowing in the sea, his mind was from now on progressing incessantly towards the holy feet of the Divine Mother of the universe. As days went by, the devotion and eagerness of the master increased more and more. The continuous flow of his mind towards the spiritual goal had its effects on the body too, giving rise to various physical symptoms. Now he's neglecting his health, neglecting his body, neglecting all other comforts. He's taking less sleep. He's doing more hard work to please the Divine Mother, to do more sadhanas. So naturally it will tell upon his body, mind and everything. So the continuous flow of the mind towards the spiritual goal and its effect on the body too, giving rise to various physical symptoms. So it was started just like when we do a lot of work, you don't have time for our comforts, so that it will come out as diseases in the form of showing so many different symptoms. Now his need for food and sleep decreased. Where is the time to think of food and sleep? So his need for food and sleep decreased as the blood in his body was always moving speedily to his chest and brain. His chest appeared constantly reddish because all the time he's thinking of God in the heart and in the center of the eyebrow, or his emotions is always rushing up to think of the God. So the blood is naturally, the blood flow towards the brain is the highest. The biggest artery takes it to the brain. Major portion goes to the brain. Only the rest few comes to other part of the body. So that is the natural tendency of the heart to pump in more to the brain. But now because of the spiritual surge of emotions, much more blood is rushing towards the chest and towards the head. So his head, his chest would be always, as the blood in his body was always moving speedily to his chest and brain, his chest appeared constantly reddish. And his eyes became sometimes suddenly filled with tears. He felt a great eagerness for the realization of the divine, and his mind was seized with an incessant anxiety as to what he should do and how he could have her vision. That's called divine dispassion, divine discontentment. We have discontentment for so many worldly objects, people, objects. But this was for the divine. So it's called divine dispassion, divine discontentment. Everything is becoming positive, even discontentment, sorrow. Arjuna had Vishada, sorrow. Turned it towards Krishna, it became yoga. Arjuna Vishada Yoga, the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Likewise, even that divine discontentment, I have not seen the mother. I have not realized the truth. I have not realized God. That discontentment turned towards God, became a positive character. So he felt a great eagerness for the realization of the divine. And his mind was seized with an incessant anxiety as to what he should do and how he could have her vision. See, even anxiety, worry, everything turned towards God will become divinized. I told how jealousy turned towards God. Ramprasad, you gave darshan to him, that great saint. Why have you not given darshan to me, vision to me? So healthy jealousy. Jealousy also turned towards God, becomes a positive character and lift you, push you towards God. Likewise, anxiety, it's very dangerous to the body. Worry, turning towards God, and it has become divinized. It become positive. He felt a great eagerness for the realization of the divine, and his mind was seized with an incessant anxiety as to what he should do and how he could have a vision. Therefore, there was in his body a state of restlessness and lack of tranquility. At all times, except when he was meditating or worshipping. So that constant restlessness, I have not got her. Vision, I have to realize her. The constant restlessness was there. So therefore, there was in his body a state of restlessness and lack of tranquility at all times except when he was meditating and worshipping. We were told by the master himself that one day at that time he sang for the divine mother to hear and then prayed to her, weeping in his eagerness to have her vision. These are the own words of issued from the sacred lips of master himself, Ramakrishna himself. We were told by the master himself that one day at that time he sang for the divine mother to hear and then prayed to her, weeping in his eagerness to have the vision. How did he pray? What is Ramakrishna telling about his own worship and prayer? Dost thou not, O mother, hear even a little of my many prayers? O mother, divine mother, dost thou not, O mother, hear even a little of many prayers I addressed to thee? Thou didst show thyself to Ramaprasad and other saints. Why shouldst thou not then reveal thyself to me? He used to say, there was then an intolerable anguish in my heart because I could not have her vision. Just as a man wrings a towel forcibly to squeeze out all the water from it. Now you use the washing machine, you do not know. In olden days, while manually we were washing cloths, suppose there is this turkey towel, it will be very thick. And when you put it into the water after the soap and putting into the water, then you have to squeeze the water. So how do you take little by little and squeeze that turkey towel, which has a lot of water? So you squeeze it to wring out the water. So Ramakrishna is giving that example, is telling that he felt like that. He used to say, there was then an intolerable anguish in my heart because I could not have a vision. Just as a man rings, it's not R-I-N-G, it is W-R-I-N-G, rings a towel forcibly to squeeze out all the water from it. I felt as if somebody caught hold of my heart and mind and was wringing them likewise. Greatly afflicted with the thought that I might never have mother's vision, I was in great agony. I thought that there was no use in living such a life. My eyes suddenly fell upon the sword that was there in the mother's temple. I made up my mind to put an end to my life with it that very moment. So such was the anguish. Such was the restlessness. After paying so much, after praying so much, after singing for her, doing all this service, mother, can't you hear me? Felt very bad. What is the use of living without mother? Vision of the mother. So what is he going to do? We'll take up that tomorrow in the next class. Very interesting point. We have stopped with a lot of suspense. So we will take up the reading tomorrow because it's already 10 minutes more for 8 o'clock. So now let it be the session of question and answer and doubt. So I request, if anybody is having any doubt or question about today's discussion, we can discuss about it. You can freely ask if you have any questions or doubts about the today's discussion. Minutes more, so you can ask questions if you have any.
Pranam Maharaj.
Pranams.
Madhu, oh, yeah, Maharaj.
Madhu, please tell.
Maharaj, if we understand these two divergent paths, one is neti neti and one is iti iti.
Yes.
If we understand this, they are divergently opposite paths.
It looks divergent. Apparently, it looks like that.
Yeah, but yeah, if I said to start from my home, and if I want to reach London, I have to go south. Mm. If I go towards north, I reach Birmingham. So how do I reach the same destination if I totally travel in a different direction?
So now, Earth is round, isn't it?
Yes.
Go forward. How did Vasco da Gama, while going from his Portugal, this thing, he came to, instead of on the land route, he went round the whole continent and came to India, isn't it? Instead of the land route, he took the sea route, it went round the Cape of Good Hope, then came to India, he found it. That means it's a little difficult. This is more easy, that's what Krishna told. The path of bhakti is very easy, accepting everything. That is a little difficult. Outright, you reject everything. Not God. But that is very intense. That's why Krishna tells, though both of them take you to the same goal, the important thing is that this is easy and common for all common people like us. So people who don't have body consciousness, who have to completely, you have to base your sadhana on your self-effort and self-effort only. No help other than that. Here in the Bhakti Yoga, you have your deity, the personal deity, Ishtadevata coming to your help always, your guru coming to your help. There in that path, it is only your pure self-effort, but it takes you to the same goal. So common people can take up devotion, and you can also take up combine with the help of Jnana Yoga, because Jnana Yoga mind makes your mind broad and it will not bring in fanaticism. Just pure devotion, going through the path of devotion, you develop fanaticism. So then you will start hating other paths. You will start hating other devotees who are not going through your own way. You can see that in some of the devotees, you will develop fanaticism. So Ramakrishna tells, Jnana Mishrita Bhakti. Combine devotion, make that devotion as the main thing, and take the help of Jnana, the path of knowledge, and go forward. So that's why Ramakrishna, Swami Vivekananda is given in our order the combination, harmonious combination of all four yogas. That is the indication of our emblem. So you might have seen in our emblem the snake going round, that is the Kundalini. It is indication of Rajyoga, meditation and Rajyoga, Patanjali Maharshi's Rajyoga. Then you see the rising sun. So the rising sun in the emblem is the Jnana Yoga. So the sun, knowledge. Then you see the wavy water of the sea, choppy water of the sea. So that is the Karma Yoga. Then we have the lotus and the leaf of the lotus, though in the water, it is not attaching to the water. So that is Bhakti Yoga. Then if you combine Samanvaya, it's called in Sanskrit Samanvaya. If you combine nicely all the four yogas, then your progress to realize God, that is Hamsa. So in the center, there is a swan. So the Paramahamsa, Paramatman, So you can realize Paramatman by a harmonious combination, samanmaya, of all the four goals. So you can keep up, suppose you have liking towards Bhakti Yoga, take Bhakti Yoga as the main path and take the help of all other things and go forward. So that is the path shown by Swami Vivekananda with that emblem. Our emblem, you can see that snake round, and inside we see the choppy waters, that's Karma Yoga, the Raja Yoga. Then this rising sun is the Gnana Yoga. Then the lotus in the water with this leaf not touching to the water is the Bhakti Yoga. Then you will get to realize Paramatman. So combining them is the best way. So there is no contradiction, it is complementary.
Okay. Okay, Maharaj.
Yeah, thank you. Any other questions? Or any other doubts?
Pranam, Maharaj.
Pranams. Anil, please tell.
Maharaj, how to remove these Ashtapashas?
I have not completed the Ashtapasha because I have come to the 6th or 7th one. Tomorrow when I complete that, you will get the answer. I am bringing to that because I should not be in a hurry to go there. The suspense will go away. Mm-hmm. I will build up everything, all the Pashas. Mm-hmm. I will take you to. At the end, it is there in the thing. I will come to you tomorrow because I have not yet completed all the Pashas. There are still, I have finished only 6 Pashas. There are 2 more. After that, I will tell you. It is there. I am bringing, coming to that.
Maharaj, when we are doing the kind of Vipassana kind of meditation in the beginning.
I can't hear you.
Maharaj, when we are doing the Vipassana kind of meditation in the beginning times, so we will get a lot of thoughts which are very dangerous. Like later observing those things, then I got it like this. It is something like a rabies vaccine.
See, if you have not taken initiation from the Guru, then you can follow all those things, Vipassana and other things. If you try to keep your legs, you have only 2 legs. If you try to keep your legs in too many boats, so each boat will start taking you in different direction. The resultant force will be, you will be torn apart. You know, in physics, there is a thing called resultant force. So if you keep your legs in too many boats, then it will be confusion and it will derail your mind. So please don't go for too many things, hodgepodge. Whatever your guru has given, sincerely proceed forward in that path and it will take you. Just have faith in the words of the guru. Do whatever the guru has told you. Don't go into, if you have not got the guru diksha, one path, you have to faith in that and go. If you have already done that, only take the help of Vipassana meditation. But don't combine, don't make chow chow or kichdi of spiritual life. Don't make your life and your mind a kichdi. Take up one path, think of it, dream of it. Let all the blood and everything, the veins, everything beat towards that one goal. That is the method. Don't try to experiment so many things. What can be done in the beginning? If you have not got Mantra Diksha. So if you have already got the Guru and Mantra Diksha, just only take the help efforts for that, but follow only whatever the Guru has told you.
Thank you, Pranam.
Any other questions?
Thank you, Maharaj, for the great advice. The great advice given now to Anil's question. Thank you for that.
Yes, Mother. We have some more minutes, 3 or 4 minutes. If anybody has any doubts or questions.
Pranam Maharaj, Kumar Swami from Bangalore.
Yeah, please tell Kumar Swami.
Maharaj, many of my friends keep asking about teachings of Ramakrishna. Initially, which should I suggest, Maharaj?
Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna is there.
They are new to the Ramakrishna order. for them, which book should I suggest?
So many are there in English and even in the local language. Many revered Somanathananda Maharaj. In English also, condensed gospel is there, and the teachings are separated. Different teachings are given there. So if you go to the bookstall in Bangalore, you can get so many varieties, not one more. There are hundreds of books. So you go on through that, and you yourself will come to know which is very simple. And you can also know what kind of the friend he is, what is his nature. Based on that, you can get a particular book.
Okay, Maharaj.
Okay, Kumar Swami.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you. Namaste, Jai Ram. So a few more minutes are there. If any question and doubt, we can continue, or I will close it with the prayer.
Namaste, Swami.
Namaste. Please,
Reggie.
Yeah, Reggie, please tell.
No doubts at the moment. I'm digesting all the information you've been giving us. I'd like to compliment you for 15 decades studying to become a facilitator. And the way you present your courses is just absolutely amazing. Like they set the facts, you will repeat the facts. So it gets entrenched in our minds. But
yeah.
Also, it's very interesting when certain words come up, like wing, and you said it starts with a W. So that we don't miss conceptualize what you're saying. I'm very, very impressed, and thank you very much, and compliments on your presentation. I'm very, very amazed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Reggie. Namaste. Jai Ram Krishna.
Thank you.
So it's almost 8 o'clock. Two or three minutes are there. If you have any doubts or questions, or else we will close with a prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshah Sarva Yagneshwaro Harihi. तस्मिन् तुष्टे जगत् तुष्टं प्रेणिते प्रेणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्री रामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु.